Today, I would like to present you some work about the systemic impact of cancer-induced inflammation on hematopoiesis. Yes. So, my lab currently is working on how myeloid cells, in particular dendritic cells and macrophages, regulate anti-tumor immunity. And we do that mostly in the tumor microenvironment. But and why are we doing that? Is because, as you just heard, myeloid cells density within the tumor microenvironment is rather associated to a bad prognosis for patients, and this is because these myeloid cells can secrete tumor growth factor or pro-angiogenic factors, and they can also exert immunosuppression on T cells. So far in immunotherapy, as you know, most of the therapy that work are T cell centers, and they act by reinvigorating activation of T cells within tumor. And there are over 600 clinical trials trying also to modulate the myeloid cell counterpart in the tumor microenvironment. And the idea here is to modulate a break that is imposed by these myeloid cells on the T cells. But so far, as it has been said earlier, nothing is really working efficiently. And one reason for that, one of the many reasons, could be also that these myeloid cells have a very fast turnover in the tumor. And another hallmark of cancer is that in the blood of both mouse and human bearing cancer, you have an accrual of circulating neutrophils, monocytes, and even progenitor cells that will continuously fuel the tumor microenvironment with myeloid cells. And these circulating myeloid cells also come from the bone marrow, from the hematopoietic process that is also continuously replenishing these circulating myeloid cells. So a few years ago, with Johan Gerber, it was my first PhD student, we wanted to understand whether there could be a crosstalk between localized tumors that will not metastasize to the bone marrow and the bone marrow itself and the hematopoiesis. And this crosstalk could fuel these myeloid cells within the circulation and then within the tumor cells. And there were already reports showing that indeed the tumor and some tumor derived factor like growth factor for myeloid cells or a factor that will also act on some stromal niches were providing some survival or reprogrammation factors to mature myeloid cells. But we wanted to go a bit upstream of these mature myeloid cells and really look at hematopoiesis. So here we got really interested in hematopoietic stem cells, so these cells that are on the top of the hematopoietic tree, and that have a very wired homeostasis, and these cells can be quiescent with a high self-renewal capacity and multipotency, and upon some stimuli can also become more active, decrease their self-renewal capacity, and start to commit to certain lineages. And what is also known in the literature is that some chronic inflammation has already an impact on at this top level of the hematopoietic tree. So low-grade LPS or poly-IC can also impact on this homeostasis in the bone marrow, IL-1 as well, and also some pulmonary infection. So at the time, we asked whether cancer and the chronic inflammation that is also generated in cancer can also impact these HSCs. And to do so, we used an autochthonous mouse model, a transgenic mouse model that spontaneously developed mammary breast cancer. and that mimic quite well the human disease. And we found that in the tumor microenvironment of these breast tumors, we had a really a high infiltration of myeloid cells. That was a good model for us. We also, I will not show it here, use other models, even transplanted models, where we had a high prevalence of myeloid cell infiltrate. And what we found here in this model is that in the circulation, we had more myeloid cells in frequency and in cell number. So we thought it was a good model to ask this question. And one of the first experiments that Johan did was to purify stem cells and progenitor from wild-type bone marrow from mice bearing CD45.1 a congenic marker, and to engraft these HSPCs into wild-type mice or tumor-bearing animals that were age-matched and that were not irradiated. So here, the parameter that was changing here was the presence of the tumor, and the question we asked was, is there a systemic rewiring of this organism when you have a breast tumor developing? And what we found is that the progeny of these wild-type HSPCs was different between these two animals. So in when transplanting into wild-type mice, you had about 10% of myeloid cells that were generated in the progeny in the spleen, but when you implanted these in the spleen of these animals, you had much more myeloid cells generated. So indeed, in tumor-bearing animals, there is a systemic rewiring that seems to promote myeloid cell differentiation from stem cells. So we looked in the bone marrow of these animals, and what we found, and others have found also, is that there was an increase in hematopoietic stem cells and progenitor, called here LSK, in tumor-bearing animals, and this is quantified here in percentage and in number, and these cells were also more proliferating. And this is correlated to the tumor burden. So next, in collaboration with Leila Perrier and Jason Cosgrove at Institut Curie, we perform single-cell RNA-seq on these hematopoietic stem cells and progenitors. And after having identified the HSCs, the lymphoid prime progenitors, myeloid prime progenitors, erythroid prime progenitor, and some cycling cells, we looked at what was the difference between LSK from wild-type animals or from tumor-bearing animals in the bone marrow. And here, when you look at the density plots, you clearly see a complete shift in the proportion of these LSK, with an increase here in these myeloid prime progenitors, and also a quite a striking shift in the transcriptome profile of the HSCs. And so we decided to take this LSK as a whole and to compare wild-type and PYMT LSK. And we took all the upregulated genes in the PYMT LSK and designed signatures to see where it would map on our single-cell data. And we saw that it was mapping really on this MMP3 myeloid progenitors. So again, showing that there was a myeloid rewiring really at the top of this hematopoietic tree. And then we got interested in these HSC clusters that you can see one is enriched in wild-type LSK and another is enriched in PYMT LSK. And again, when we looked at the transcript that were upregulated in PYMT LSK, we saw many transcripts related to myeloid differentiation, including MPO, cathepsin G, ALAN, and CBPV. So we ask whether this would translate biologically to a self-autonomous expansion of these HSC. So we sorted long-term HSC, so the most quiescent cells in the hematopoiesis, and we cultured these in vitro with myeloid-promoting a combo of cytokines. And what we saw is that indeed, long-term HSCs from PYMT tumor-bearing animals were more prone to expand in this culture medium and were also more prone to generate myeloid cells. And next, we move to an in vivo classical hematopoiesis settings, where here we irradiated the host, lethally irradiated the host, and transfer to replenish the immune system. We transfer 1,000 long-term HSCs together with some supportive bone marrow, either from wild-type or PYMT animals. And we look at the progeny. First, we looked if these cells were able to reconstitute this lethally irradiated host, and also what was the progeny of these cells. And what we found is that there was a very good reconstitution of the immune system by this HSC coming from the cancer-bearing mice, which is not always the case in some chronic inflammation where HSCs get sort of exhausted and cannot replenish a host. Here, they were completely able to replenish this host, and there was a transient myeloid bias that was then disappearing, but we could still see significantly elevated at 2 weeks. So here, as the first conclusion, what we found is that when in this model, where again I need to stress that these breast cancer are localized to the breast tissue and do not metastasize to the bone, we see an increase of myeloid cells in the blood, and in the bone marrow we see an increase in HSCs, MMP3, and globally of LSK. So then we ask what could be tumor-derived inflammatory cues that would rewire this bone marrow hematopoiesis. So we perform a protein array by comparing in the serum wild-type and PYMT animals. And here are the reproducibly increased protein that we could detect in the serum of tumor-bearing animals. And what was quite surprising is that we could find three proteins that were involved in bone remodeling. And so when we injected in a PYMT tumor-bearing animal some fluorescent probe to see the activity of the bone of these mice, we saw that indeed these tumor-bearing mice had higher bone activity, and this is quantified here. So this was going along with the idea that there was some, from the tumor, some factors that were promoting bone production. So then we had to dig a bit further into what was the hematopoiesis and the hematopoietic niche. So indeed, in the bone, in the bone marrow, you have these HSCs that I told you are really wired to have a very tight homeostasis, but they are not here by themselves. They are, of course, within the bone, and this is the bone tissue. You have the osteoblasts that are cells generating the bone, and the osteoclasts that are cells resorbing the bone. And you also have, among many other cell types, but here I wanted to simplify the scheme, you also have some stromal cells, including, of course, endothelial cells that are that make all this vasculature of the bone marrow and that regulate trafficking of cells. And these endothelial cells are surrounded by mesenchymal stem cells that have a dual role. They are stem cells themselves, so they are there to generate adipocyte or osteoblast, but they are also there to provide a niche to hematopoietic stem cells, and they do so by... They do so by providing, for instance, a growth factor to maintain quiescence of these HSCs, or some chemokines like CXCL12 to retain the HSCs within the bone marrow. And so when we look at this stromal compartment of tumor-bearing animals, what we found is that these MSCs were increased in number. Here, it's quantified here. And so we performed single-cell RNA-seq on this stromal compartment of the bone marrow. We were able to detect these MSCs that express CXCL12 and leptin receptor, the osteoblast, fibroblast subset, and endothelial cells. And when we compare by density plot the PYMT versus wild-type stromal cells, we found that these MSCs were expanded, as we saw in flow cytometry, were expanding in tumor-bearing animals. And when we looked at differentially expressed gene between all these stromal clusters, we found that the most rewired subset were the MSCs with some transcript enriched in GOTAM for cellular response to stress, cytokine signaling, and TLR receptor cascade. So we also probe whether these MSCs, these rewired MSCs, were changing their stem cell activity, and we sorted these CD51 MSCs and cultured them in a bone-promoting medium. And what we found is that they had an enhanced osteogenic differentiation when they were isolating from tumor-bearing animals. So next, we wanted to, as Brian was saying, to really look in the tissue what was happening and if we could really find a remodeling of this bone and bone niche and hematopoietic niche. And here we collaborated with the fantastic lab of Diana Passaro, who is an expert in imaging the bones. And she started to explore the bones of these tumor-bearing animals by staining the bone in cells with collagenase 1, vessels with CD31, MSCs with leptin receptor, immune cells that were lean positive, CD48 positive, and we excluded from this lineage HSCs that were stained with CD150. So here are images of the vasculature within the bone. And so you see here it's also irrigate the bone itself. It's also in the medulla. And here you see the immune cells that are within the blood vessels. And when she quantified all the parameters of this vasculature of the bone, she found that in tumor-bearing animals, all parameters like diameter, volume, or length were remodeled within tumor-bearing animals, showing that distantly the tumor is able to completely remodel this organ. Then we looked at these famous MSCs. We indeed find that in the wild-type animals, they were found perivascular with this elongated shape around vessels. But in tumor-bearing animals, they were detaching from these vessels and forming these round, bright cells. Then we search for these rare HSCs. So here you can see in pink the CD150 positive HSCs. And we also looked, probed their spatial distribution. And we did so also in regard of these MSCs. And what we found here is that in tumor-bearing animals, we had the distance between HSCs and MSCs was reduced, so they were close, more close together than before. So what Johan did to probe whether these MSCs would promote myelopoiesis of long-term HSCs, he sorted wild-type long-term HSCs and co-cultured them with MSCs sorted either from wild-type animals or from tumor-bearing animals. And he found that these MSCs from tumor-bearing animals were indeed able to promote myeloid cell differentiation in vitro. And there was a synergistic effect between MSCs and HSCs. As I showed you earlier, they have a cell intrinsic bias to generate myeloid cells. And here, when you co-culture both HSCs and MSCs from these tumor-bearing animals, this myeloid cell production is further improved. So now I will show you some very preliminary unpublished data that so we are trying to understand which type of factor could really account for this rewiring in the bone marrow. And so we were interested in this osteoprotegerin, OPG, that was elevated in tumor-bearing animal serum, because OPG is a decoy receptor for RANK ligand, which is a growth factor for osteoclasts that destroy the bone. So there is always a balance between osteoclast and osteoblast to generate bone tissue. So we CRISPRed out OPG in a tumor cell line that was recapitulating our phenotype. We found that in vitro, this knockout was not changing the the proliferation of these tumor cells, so there was no cell intrinsic defect here. But when we implanted these tumor knockout cells in vivo, we found that these OPG knockout PYMT, PY230 were decreased their tumor growth. And when we supplemented these mice with an adenovirus secreting OPG, we supplemented OPG knockout tumors, we found that they could restore partially the growth of this tumor. And in the serum of these mice, again, we found no OPG secreted. In the bone marrow, we found a decrease in HSPCs, in MSCs level, and in their rewiring. And in the tumor, we saw less myeloid cells per volume of tissue. So I would like to end, if I have just 30 seconds, so to find some human relevance. I think it's important in this meeting. So in Institut Curie, there was a study that has shown that upon PET, upon FDG labeling and PET scan images, you could stratify patients between that had no metastasis in the bone marrow, but where the metabolism of the bone was of the entire bone marrow was really increased in some patients, and that was correlating with worse prognosis for them. So an open question that many of us are asking is, could normalization of hematopoiesis and its bone marrow niche represent an actionable pathway to treat cancer patients? And so I would like to thank my group and Johan that led beautifully this work and all the collaborators and funding, and thank you for your attention.